Recorded Books in RB Digital present Mayo Clinic Guide to Raising a Healthy Child, written by Angela C. Mattke, MD. Narrated by Lori Gardner. Introduction. Raising a child is an adventure with a lot of rewards and many unknowns. Fortunately, there are plenty of opportunities to provide your child with balanced, healthy life choices and to build a strong foundation that allows your child to weather life's inevitable ups and downs. How you teach your child at an early age to face challenges and setbacks will prepare him or her to face bigger challenges in middle school, high school, and beyond. Don't worry too much if your family encounters struggles ahead. Parenting in any shape or form is rarely an easy task, but a commitment to a loving and nurturing relationship with a child has profound and lifelong rewards. We understand that every family is different in its makeup and how it functions to raise a healthy child. When we use the word parent, it means any loving and supportive person devoted to raising a child. We hope that no matter what your parenting situation, you'll find the information in this book helpful and meaningful. This book is the work of many individuals with a special interest or expertise in childhood development. A special thanks to all of those who helped make it possible. Part 1. Growth and Development. Chapter 1. Welcome to the preschool and school age years. You've made it through the all-consuming baby and toddler years with your child. It's been quite a ride. Exhilarating, exhausting, and everything in between. You've poured your heart and soul into this little being who has required so much of your time and energy, but has given you so much in return. You've delighted in all the ways he or she has grown and changed. With each passing day, you've learned a little more about who your child is. Throughout it all, your routines and parenting strategies have no doubt evolved to match your changing son or daughter. Adapting to these changes, you've realized, is a big part of being a parent. Now you're embarking on a new phase, the preschool years. This period is sometimes called the wonder years. No longer in need of constant supervision, your child has become an explorer, filled with wonder and curiosity. Boundaries are being tested, and the world beyond the family is opening up. Your little one is making friends and connecting with teachers or other adults. He or she is becoming much more talkative, expressing likes and dislikes, often loudly and clearly. You've noticed that your child's increasing ability to cooperate with daily tasks goes hand in hand with a desire for more independence. These changes can be both exciting and challenging. Maybe you're already beyond the preschool years. In middle childhood, days spent at home or in a childcare setting give way to hours immersed in school life, sports, and extracurricular and social activities. Your son or daughter will continue to undergo enormous changes in all areas of development, from growing physically and emotionally to making amazingly logical arguments about allowances and cell phone privileges. You'll celebrate the pleasures of this newfound confidence and independence right along with your child and offer guidance during times of struggle. As your child's ability to reason, communicate, and manage his or her feelings increases, you'll marvel at the way your baby is growing up into his or her own person. Through all these stages, you'll continue to experience glorious and not-so-glorious moments with your child. Like everything else in life, parenting has its ups and downs. One minute you're loving the sounds of laughter and joyful noise filling the house. The next minute, you're tearing your hair out because all you want is some peace and quiet. Some days you feel as if you know what you're doing. And other days, maybe most, you feel as if you're winging it. That's completely normal and to be expected. After all, parenting is the ultimate learn-as-you-go job. Being a good parent. With a couple of years of parenting under your belt, you know a lot more than you did when you first held your newborn baby. Even so, every day seems to bring more to learn. You're still trying to figure out the best way to do this parenting job. This book was written to help you along the way. But don't let the desire to be a good parent turn into pressure to be the perfect parent. Just as there are no perfect children, there are no perfect parents. Even parents who seem to have it all together bungle things or lose their patience sometimes. Messing up is a normal, even healthy, part of parenting. It's how we learn and improve. You won't ruin your child if you make a mistake, and be prepared to make plenty of them. Your child is tougher, wiser, and more resilient than you think. Instead of expecting to do everything right all the time, focus on being a committed parent. Set yourself reasonably high standards, but recognize that you'll sometimes fall short. What matters is how you view those inevitable blunders and misguided parenting attempts. That you see yourself as being in this for the long haul, and know that one mistake isn't the end of the world. Rather than beating yourself up or dwelling endlessly on every mishap, look at failures as opportunities to try a new approach. Use your missteps as a chance to reflect on your parenting style and assess how it's matching up with your child. Forgive yourself for not getting it right the first time and strive to do better next time. What your child will notice is that you care and are trying. By cutting yourself some slack, you'll be able to relax and enjoy parenting a lot more. And that will free you up to be more loving and empathetic towards your child. What's more, you'll be modeling a healthy approach to life's challenges by letting your child see that you're willing to learn from your experiences. If you and your child can face the struggles ahead together, you'll also learn to be a family together. People who can lean on each other no matter what happens. As you step forward on this wonderful parenting journey, here are a few key points to keep in mind. Trust your instincts. You know more than you think you do. Have confidence in your ability to figure things out, even if it takes some trial and error. On the flip side, remember that even the most seasoned parents sometimes find themselves at a complete loss. It's okay to seek advice from friends, family, and medical professionals. If you get unsolicited advice, take the advice that fits with your parenting values and feel free to forget the rest. Make time to reflect. Life as a parent can be downright hectic, and you may feel as if you barely have time to breathe. Sometimes it's enough just to get through the day and collapse into your bed at night. But if possible, try to carve out some time alone or with your partner now and then to look at the big picture. What parenting strategies are working? What might need to be tweaked or reinvented? What used to work when your child was a preschooler but isn't working so well now that he or she is a kindergartner? Asking yourself these kinds of questions will help keep you in tune with your child and the kind of parenting required at the present moment. Appreciate your child. As chaotic as life may seem with a child, these are precious years. Give yourself permission to step back and enjoy your son or daughter. Make room for one-on-one time when you can really be present. Pay attention to your child and try to see things from his or her point of view. Take joy in the little things. For all the challenges that come with raising a child, parenting also brings an incredible richness to daily living. Take care of yourself. Taking good care of your child involves taking good care of yourself. The better you feel, the better able you'll be to care for and enjoy your son or daughter. Give yourself permission to take breaks from the responsibilities of parenting. Make time to do things you enjoy. Nurture your interests, friendships, and relationships. Your child may be the center of your universe, but it's important to find fulfillment in other ways too. This is another way of modeling mental and emotional well-being for your child. Keep a sense of humor. Everyone has bad days, parents and children. Sometimes things might get so frustrating that the only way out is to laugh it off and start over. Seeing the humor in a situation can lighten your mood, give you a clearer perspective, and help you stay balanced. It can also help teach your child resilience and how to take a positive approach toward life's challenges. Using humor with your child can be a powerful tool in your parenting toolkit. This book. As you maneuver the ins and outs of parenting, a little guidance and reassurance can be of great help. Mayo Clinic Guide to Raising a Healthy Child is designed to help you find answers to common questions during your child's preschool and middle years. The book is also intended to provide you with reassurance that you're doing well and that the emotions and concerns you may be experiencing are the same as those of many other parents. Dig in with whatever approach works best for you. You can turn the page and begin reading, or you can selectively choose those chapters or sections that are most important to you right now. Keep the book handy so that you can return to it when a concern arises, or to prepare yourself for what may be in store in the years ahead. Remember that parenting is an adventure. Enjoy the journey. Chapter 2. Preschool Years. The preschool years are an active time for parents. Preschoolers are full of energy and enthusiasm. Their zest for life is contagious, but also sometimes exhausting. Their physical abilities and curiosity are on the upswing, yet they still need close supervision while they learn the rules of safety. Limits will need to be set and will no doubt be challenged by your child, sometimes loudly. As preschoolers grow in confidence and improve how they communicate, they bring a whole new dimension to family life. It's exciting to watch your child grow and reach new heights. From toilet training to getting ready to enter school, there are lots of important lessons to learn between the ages of 3 and 5. Developmental milestones. As children grow, they're constantly developing new skills. Things most kids can do by a certain age are called developmental milestones. When exactly these occur varies from child to child, as each child follows his or her own growth curve and pattern of development. But checking that milestones are progressing and occur within a certain age range helps monitor development and provides early clues about any potential delays. Tracking milestones is an important part of your child's annual checkup. Your child's medical provider may have you fill out a questionnaire that assesses your child's developmental stage and then compare that information with data from other children of the same age. Developmental milestones are often split up into the following categories: physical development and movement, language and speech development, social and emotional development, mental development. In this chapter, you'll learn about typical preschooler milestones. If you have questions about how your child is developing at any time, don't hesitate to ask your child's medical provider. Physical development and movement. Your child is becoming stronger and more agile with each passing day. In fact, you may find your child easily running ahead of you in the park, effortlessly tackling a flight of stairs, or pumping his or her legs on the swing like it's second nature. This is also a time when your child's abilities are ahead of his or her decision-making skills, so you'll need to help your child learn to stay within safe limits and keep an eye out for potential hazards. Height and weight gain. Compared with the first couple of years of life, growth during the preschool years slows down considerably. Typical gains during this time are about 4 to 5 pounds and 2 to 3 inches in height a year. Your child's abdominal area may be starting to slim down, and his or her legs are getting longer. Some children add inches to their height faster than they add pounds and may take on a thinner appearance. Most children eventually fill out as their bodies develop more muscle. The preschool years are also a time when even good eaters can get picky about their food. This is part of growing up and becoming more independent. Eating can also be erratic, with your child refusing to eat dinner one day and devouring everything the next. In most cases, children manage to get ample nutrition during the course of a week. Offering a variety of nutritious foods at mealtimes and letting your child decide how much he or she wants to eat is often one of the best ways to handle picky eaters. If you feel like your child may not be getting proper nutrition, talk with your child's medical provider. Gross motor development. At this age, your child is probably performing some pretty complicated moves using his or her large muscles. Throwing a ball, riding a bike, or climbing a tree. How well a child does with these large muscle tasks varies from child to child during this time. As long as your child seems to be improving his or her skills, there's typically no cause for worry. However, if you're concerned about delays, reach out to your child's medical provider. Walking with the knees turned slightly inward, knock-kneed, and having mild flat feet, where arches in the feet are less pronounced, aren't uncommon in this age group and usually don't require treatment. Fine motor development. Increased development in brain and muscle coordination allows your preschooler to use his or her hands and fingers as much more precise tools than in the toddler years. Preschoolers are learning to manipulate forks and spoons to feed themselves and manage buttons and zippers to get themselves dressed. The objects in your child's drawings are becoming more recognizable, and you may be flattered to see you're often a subject of these pictures. Children tend to depict in their drawings and paintings those things that are important to them. Developmental skills by age. By a certain age, most children can do certain things. By age 3, physical. Walk up and down stairs, alternating feet. Climb, run, and pedal a tricycle. String small beads together. Cut awkwardly with scissors from side to side. Language. Speak 250 to 500 words or more. Speak in 3- and 4-word sentences. State first name. Speak clearly enough for strangers to understand about 75% of the time. Social. Take turns. Express affection openly. Easily separate from parents. Understand routine. May get upset with major changes. Mental. Turn book pages one at a time. Copy a circle. Do puzzles with 3 or 4 pieces. By age 4, physical. Hop or stand on 1 foot for 2 seconds. Catch a bounced ball most of the time. Use scissors with supervision. Language. Answer simple questions. Use sentences with 4 or more words. Speak clearly all of the time. Use words for feelings. Social. Cooperate with other children. Talk about likes and dislikes. Become more creative with make-believe play. Mental. Print some capital letters. Draw a person with 2 to 4 body parts. Understand the idea of counting. start to understand time. By age 5, physical. Stand on 1 foot for at least 10 seconds. Hop, skip, swing, and do somersaults. Use the toilet independently. Language. Understand rhyming. Use sentences that give multiple details. Use the future tense. State full name. Social. Want to be like his or her friends. Follow rules and instructions. Be aware of gender. Like to sing, act, and dance. Mental. Know about common items, such as food and money. Count 10 or more objects. Copy a triangle and other geometric patterns. Vision. Though eyesight can vary, by the age of 4, many children have developed 20/20 vision. However, eye problems may develop in childhood, and it's important to address them promptly to help your child see better and prevent complications. Have your child's vision checked by an ophthalmologist, optometrist, pediatrician, or other trained eye specialist at least once between ages 3 and 5. Your child's eye doctor can check for and treat common childhood eye conditions, such as crossed eyes, strabismus, and decreases in vision, amblyopia. These involve problems with the muscles of the eye and coordination between eye and brain activity. Treatment can help correct the problem and improve your child's vision. It may include the use of eyeglasses, eye drops, or an eye patch. Dental. At this point, all of your child's baby teeth should be in place. Encourage twice daily brushing with fluoride toothpaste, as well as daily flossing. And visit your child's dentist regularly for dental checkups and cleaning. Taking care of your child's teeth now can help prevent painful and costly dental problems in the future. Sleep. By this age, many children can sleep for 11 to 13 hours at night. By age 4, many children stop taking naps. Even when this is the case, though, plan for a quiet period of rest at a regular time each day. This helps prevent your child from becoming too excited or tired. Keep a regular bedtime routine for your child. Bedtime may come earlier when naps are stopped. Encourage your child to fall asleep in his or her own bed and sleep there through the night. Language and speech. It's amazing to think how far your child has come in a few short years, from the babbling of babyhood to the expanding vocabulary of preschool. This period marks the most rapid growth in terms of language development. By now, your child may know close to 2,000 words, and his or her sentences are more complex. As a general rule, your child's sentences typically will include words for each year of his or her age. For example, 4-word sentences for a 4-year-old. He or she will begin understanding concepts such as bigger and smaller, follow more involved instructions, name colors, and learn to count to 10 by age 5. Children at this age also begin using the past and future tense. Evolving language in a young child is an important development. It provides him or her with the tools to communicate without having to act out emotions. If your child seems to have a language delay, make sure to discuss it with your child's medical provider to rule out an underlying disorder. Parents may become concerned if they notice their preschooler is stuttering. Rest assured, it's not uncommon for children to stutter at this age. For example, pausing while speaking or stumbling a bit on the beginning sounds of words. This may occur more often when your child is excited or feeling stressed. Sometimes it's hard to get those words out fast enough. However, if your child's stuttering is severe, occurs frequently, or causes you concern, don't hesitate to talk to your child's medical provider. the provider may recommend evaluation by a speech pathologist. Speech therapy may be helpful for some children. Developmental delays. The term developmental delay is used when a child doesn't gain skills following typical pediatric milestones. Delays can affect multiple areas, including physical abilities, socialization, and language and speech skills. Because every child develops at his or her own pace, it can be difficult to tell whether a child is just following his or her own path or whether a developmental delay is present. Talk to your child's medical provider. If there is a developmental delay, getting your child the proper interventions and therapy early on can help manage, improve, or resolve the delays by the time he or she starts school. Your child's provider can offer guidance in obtaining any needed interventions. If at any point in your child's development, your child seems to lose skills that he or she once had, consult with your child's medical provider. Potential signs of a developmental delay. Age 3. Falls down a lot or has trouble with stairs. Drools or has very unclear speech. Can't work door handles or simple toys, such as pegboards or simple puzzles. Doesn't speak in sentences. Doesn't understand simple instructions. Doesn't play pretend or make-believe. Doesn't want to play with other children or toys. Doesn't make eye contact. Age 4. Can't jump in place. Has trouble scribbling. Shows no interest in interactive games or make-believe. Ignores other children or doesn't respond to people outside the family. Resists dressing, sleeping, and using the toilet. Can't retell a favorite story. Doesn't follow three-part commands. Doesn't understand same and different. Doesn't use me and you correctly. Speaks unclearly. Age 5. Doesn't show a wide range of emotions. Shows extreme behavior. Unusually fearful, aggressive, shy, or sad. Unusually withdrawn and not active. Easily distracted. Has trouble focusing on one activity for more than 5 minutes. Doesn't respond to people or responds only superficially. Can't tell what's real and what's make-believe. Doesn't play a variety of games and activities. Can't give first and last names. Doesn't use plurals or past tense properly. Doesn't talk about daily activities or experiences. Doesn't draw pictures. Can't brush teeth, wash and dry hands, or get undressed without help. Light the spark. Positive habits that will help encourage your child's development in the preschool years include responsibility. Let your child help you with simple chores, such as setting the table or putting clothes away. Sharing. Take turns turning the pages of a book at bedtime or playing favorite characters during games of make-believe. Socialization. Set up play dates with children who are about the same age as your child. Community recreation classes and sport leagues are great ways to meet children who share similar interests with your child. Independence. Offer your child choices. For example, let him or her pick out an outfit to wear, or what he or she would like for snack time. Listening and following directions. Add multiple steps to your requests, such as, please hang up your coat on the coat rack, wash your hands, and then help me set the table for dinner. Quiet time. Have your child engage in a quiet activity for a short amount of time, and then gradually increase the time spent doing a low-key activity. Reading and language. Avoid baby talk. Ask questions. Encourage your child to participate in conversations and read to your child every night. Make frequent trips to your local library or bookstore. Read road signs and menus together. And listen to audiobooks or kid-friendly podcasts on car rides. Practice sounding out letters. Teach your child the alphabet song and sing along too. Writing. Have your child practice holding a pencil or crayon correctly. Make practice fun by offering connect-the-dots puzzles or mazes. Supervise activities such as sorting coins or stringing beads to help improve grasp. Mathematics. Practice counting to 100. Make learning shapes fun by identifying circles, triangles, squares, and other shapes as you go for a walk or on your next car ride. General knowledge. Plan trips to museums, zoos, and child-friendly live theater. Social and emotional development. The preschool years are a time of greater exploration and interaction with other children. Your child's sharing skills have likely improved, and he or she is eager to make friends and please them. Children this age are also getting better at handling their emotions, making tantrums a little less frequent. These are all developments that help smooth the transition to kindergarten. Play. When your child was younger, he or she likely engaged in parallel play, which is playing alongside other children rather than playing with them. Now that your child is older, he or she is likely to play more cooperatively with friends and invent games with his or her own rules. Don't be surprised to see one leader in these play sessions. This is a common time for dominant children to start to lead other children around, which children generally don't seem to mind. Your child's play may involve some familiar moves, including pretending to talk on a cell phone or make dinner. However, you'll also notice your child's imagination taking flight during this stage. Play is becoming more complex, such as landing a spaceship on Mars, turning into a superhero who saves the world from dinosaurs, or becoming a famous ice cream inventor. Your child may turn to imaginary friends or use stuffed animals to act out his or her fantasies. It's also common for children to tell over-the-top stories at this age. They're still learning to distinguish between what's real and what's make-believe. By age 5, though, most children can tell the difference. Budding empathy helps preschoolers relate to others and begin to see things from another's point of view. Often, kids this age will show unprompted affection toward friends and feel bad if someone else gets hurt. The importance of unstructured play. To you, it looks like a simple game of make-believe. Story hour for an imaginary classroom full of students, or the wrangling of a menagerie of stuffed animals as head zookeeper. In reality, your child is developing a wealth of skills. Everyone's favorite neighbor, Mr. Rogers, from the beloved PBS television show, Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, summed it up best when he said, "Play is often talked about as if it were a relief from serious learning. But for children, play is serious learning." In simple terms, unstructured play is an activity that is decided upon by your child and is guided only by his or her imagination and decisions. Though you may supervise for safety's sake, this includes playing with dolls, stacking blocks, running, jumping, dancing, and playing on playground equipment. Play has been shown to help further cognitive, physical, social, and emotional development in children. It can help children fine-tune decision-making skills, acquire new interests, and allow them to move at their own pace. Academically, such play has been shown to improve the skills needed to interact with peers and solve problems. Play also gives you bonding time with your child, which is connected to increased confidence and resilience. Unfortunately, playtime can sometimes get cut out of a child's schedule, as he or she becomes more interested in watching television or playing video games. However, television and video games are considered passive, meaning they require little to no imagination. So it's important to make sure your child isn't losing playtime to them. You'll also want to consider how many community and school activities your child participates in. Participating in a lot of activities can sometimes lead to overscheduling, which leaves little downtime for children to engage in free play and has been associated with increased anxiety and stress in children. Behavior. Preschoolers are famous for testing their limits and those of their parents. This early resistance can try a parent's patience, but it's also an integral part of a child's social and emotional development. This is a time where your child is discovering two important things. Number one, that he or she still has some physical limitations, which can be a frustrating barrier to what he or she wants to do. And number two, that you don't allow him or her to do certain things, which is how he or she learns about boundaries. While preschoolers should be allowed to explore the world around them, they need clear and consistent rules to keep them safe. That's why it's important to keep enforcing rules, or you may find yourself being tested often. Temper tantrums may still occur at this age, though they're likely to be less frequent than during the toddler years. If your child is having lengthy tantrums, or having them several times a day, talk to your child's medical provider about it. The provider may offer some tips or strategies that can help and can check for any underlying issues that might be contributing to your child's mood and behavior. Children at this age also want to please their parents. Your child wants to be like you and will mimic the things you do and say. Consider this when you talk about yourself and interact with your child and others. Early examples of positive behavior will help your child learn about healthy social interactions. At the same time, because of a growing appreciation for rules and certain ways of doing things, children may get upset with major changes in routines. It's important to keep a consistent schedule for your child. If big changes are coming up, try to prepare your child ahead of time. Sexuality. It's normal for preschoolers to be curious about sex. Masturbation is common, as children often discover during this time that touching their own genitals brings pleasurable feelings. Sometimes children may touch their genitals in public. If this happens, try to distract your child or pull him or her aside and give a gentle reminder about the importance of privacy. By age 4 or 5, children generally understand that they should masturbate only when they're alone. As a parent, avoid overreacting to a child's masturbation. The preschool years are also the time when your child may develop greater feelings of modesty about his or her body, going from changing clothes in the middle of the living room to changing in his or her bedroom behind closed doors. For many parents, discussing sex begins with teaching your child about genitalia and the correct names for them. Discussions about sex should be open and honest, but in simple terms that a child this age can understand. Though popular culture has depicted the sex talk as one monumental and sometimes awkward conversation, living with a curious child will likely mean it will be many conversations over the years. Part of being a parent is having awkward moments and conversation. Don't let it stop you. While sex may be uncomfortable or awkward to discuss in the beginning, know that you'll likely get a lot more practice as time goes on. Parents also worry about the danger of sexual abuse in a young child. If your child seems overly preoccupied with things of a sexual nature or seems to know more about sex than expected for his or her age, Be alert to the possibility of inappropriate exposure to sexual matters or abuse. Talk to your child about the importance of privacy and that no one has the right to touch his or her genitalia. Reiterate that if someone does try to do so, your child should tell you right away. Toilet training. Did you envision your 4-year-old child completely toilet trained at this point? If you find that your child is still having accidents, you probably now realize how individual this milestone is for children. As tempting as it may be to compare your child's progress with that of another child of the same age, try not to. Toilet training is often a marathon, not a sprint. It's not uncommon for preschool-aged children who stay dry during the day to have occasional nighttime accidents. As a rule, girls tend to toilet train faster than boys, and successful nighttime toilet training takes longer than daytime toilet training. If your child is still having accidents, avoid disciplining your child. Instead, assure him or her that having accidents happens and that he or she will eventually master this task as he or she grows. While you wait for this transition to happen, you can make your life easier by investing in products such as nighttime trainers and waterproof mattress covers. Keep spare clothing and sheets easily accessible in case of an accident. If your child seems to be having a particularly difficult time with toilet training, or if it's become a power struggle between the two of you, consider backing off. Respond gently to accidents, but make an effort to transfer full responsibility for toileting to your child. Once your child realizes it's up to him or her to use the toilet when the urge arises, he or she is more likely to do it independently. You can also offer incentives, such as a treat or screen time, along with plenty of praise for every time your child uses the toilet independently. Reward freely at first to increase your child's motivation. If your child was previously dry and is now having accidents again, talk with his or her medical provider. A common cause of daytime accidents is chronic constipation. The muscles that control bowel movements also have an effect on urination. Treating the constipation will help resolve urinary leakage. Mental development. Preschoolers' minds are buzzing with activity. Solving puzzles, telling stories, creating art, and just being curious. During this time, you can expect your child to work his or her way up to counting to 10 and beyond. Begin printing numbers and letters, and play age-appropriate board or card games. These new skills will serve him or her well as school approaches. Off to preschool. If you're getting ready to send your child to preschool, you may wonder how it will go. As your child's first teacher, you showed him or her everything from how to use a fork at dinner to how to pedal a tricycle. So it's natural to be a little nervous or anxious about handing over the reins to someone else. If your child has spent his or her time mostly at home up till now, you may also worry about how he or she will adjust to a new setting. Preschools offer a variety of teaching styles and settings. You can look for one that best suits your child. Traditional preschool classrooms. These tend to be teacher-led classrooms, meaning children learn in a more structured environment using curriculum developed by the teacher. The curriculum is often centered around the idea that children learn through play. Alternative teaching styles. These may focus on child-centered curriculum and let the student's interests be the guide for daily learning, rather than relying on set topics. The child-led method is another approach, which is focused on each child's learning experience and gives children individual control over what developmentally appropriate activities they will do. Examples of alternative styles include Montessori method, Waldorf, Reggio Emilia, High Scope, and Bank Street. Faith-based settings. Preschools may be faith-based, such as those located in houses of worship or sponsored by a parish or faith community. They may reflect a religion's particular beliefs. Cooperatives. Some preschools may be cooperative, which requires parents to help run the school, such as helping to clean the school on certain days, organize events, or fundraising. State and federal programs. Other programs, such as Universal Pre-K or Head Start, are public programs offered free of charge in some communities. When selecting a preschool, you might look for one that offers educational activities that help prepare your child for kindergarten. Ideally, preschool teachers encourage expanded thinking and language skills by frequently engaging your child in conversation, asking your child questions that can't be answered with a simple yes or no, and using new words to help broaden his or her vocabulary. To help further reading skills, teachers may read a story and then discuss story elements and what messages they convey. Look for writing, science, math, and art components in your child's curriculum. The program should also offer feedback on your child's progress and allow you to meet with teachers. Consider your child's personality and how he or she seems to learn best. Is your child ready for kindergarten? As a child's fifth birthday approaches, parents often start to wonder, is he or she ready to enter school? Knowing the alphabet and how to count can be helpful, but being developmentally ready is just as important, if not more so. Your child may be ready for kindergarten when he or she displays these abilities: listening and taking turns while talking or asking questions, following set rules, cleaning up when asked, focusing on an activity, doing basic tasks independently, such as using the toilet and washing hands, asking for help when needed. Kindergarten readiness. In most school districts, children must be age 5 by a certain date to enroll in the upcoming academic year. However, a child's readiness to start school goes beyond a numeric age. The yardstick for determining if a child is ready has shifted away from focusing on academic preparedness, for example, knowing the alphabet and being able to count to 10, to incorporating a range of factors. These include physical health, social and emotional development, learning style, language development, and mental development. Your child's school may perform a screening prior to the start of kindergarten to evaluate these areas. Having difficulties in some of these areas doesn't necessarily mean your child shouldn't start school on time. School staff can help you determine when would be best for your child to start. In case of a developmental delay or a chronic medical condition, work closely with the school district to ensure your child receives any special services he or she may need to succeed at school. For children ages 3 and up, this typically involves an evaluation by psychologists and educators who will determine if your child qualifies for special education services. For some parents, concerns about their child not being ready may lead them to consider delaying kindergarten until the following year, particularly if the child's birthday is near the school district's cutoff date. This is a decision best made after careful consideration of the pros and cons and with input from the child's medical provider and teachers. Technology. At this age, you're still the biggest influence on your child. But slowly, elements such as TV and the internet are shaping how your child sees and responds to the world, even in the preschool years. Time spent on tech devices, commonly known as screen time, has the potential to be both intellectually stimulating and intellectually stifling. But there are ways you can manage how much it influences your preschooler's development. The American Academy of Pediatrics, AAP, recommends no more than 1 hour of screen time daily for preschoolers. This includes television, tablets, smartphones, video games, and computers. The reasons for this don't differ greatly from the reasons to limit screen time as your child gets older. Too much screen time can be disruptive to sleep and cut into bonding time with your child. Excessive screen time has also been associated with problems such as lack of physical activity and difficulty paying attention. Some parents feel pressure to introduce technology early. Given how media savvy the world has become, it's understandable that parents may feel that their child should learn how to navigate technology at a young age. But since most technology today is user-friendly and easy to learn, don't feel that you have to introduce your child to gadgets early. Your child will learn quickly when the time is right. To help curtail the overuse of technology, consider establishing screen-free zones, such as the bedroom, and screen-free times, such as mealtime, playtime, and bedtime. If you need help formulating a media plan, visit the AAP's website for parents, healthychildren.org, and search for its media plan tool. Consider these recommendations for use of specific devices within appropriate time limits. Television. There's nothing wrong with television in moderation. However, it's a good idea to limit your child's viewing schedule to shows that offer high-quality programming. Learning is enhanced when your child has an emotional investment in a show and its characters. A show such as Sesame Street, for example, can be enjoyable and educational for your child. Avoid shows with violent content and advertising, which children can have a hard time processing. Ensure your child is watching appropriate content by watching with him or her. This will also give you the opportunity to look for teachable moments and discuss what your child watches. For example, what lessons the main character learned. When your child isn't watching, turn off the television to eliminate unnecessary background noise. Computer games and apps. Not all games and apps are created equal. Many that are billed as educational have limited or no evidence of being effective. They often aren't designed to allow parents to play with their children, which can aid learning. They also don't always cover skills needed for school preparedness, such as creative thinking, which is better learned through free play. If your child does use apps, monitor his or her activity and take the app for a test drive yourself to ensure it's appropriate for your child's age. Smartphones. At this stage in your child's life, your child's smartphone use probably consists of using your phone to play games and look at photos or videos. It's up to you whether to allow your child a little time on your phone, but avoid using it to calm your child. Consider placing all of the apps your child is permitted to use on one screen or in one folder to avoid access to apps that are meant for adults or older children. Ebooks. Depending on the ebook, there may be multiple distracting features, such as pop-ups or sound effects, which can take away from the learning experience. If you plan on purchasing ebooks or borrowing them from the library, try to go with the simplest format and read them with your child. Interact as you would with a printed book. Shared reading time has been shown to enhance learning. For any internet-enabled device you let your child use, make sure to implement basic safety rules. For example, a computer, smartphone, or tablet should be kept in a highly visible area of your home so that you can monitor your child's activity. Have your child guide you through the games or other activities he or she likes to engage in. You may want to limit activity to only certain educational sites or block permission for certain functions, such as sending pictures or emailing. Finally, one of the most important things you can do as a parent is to set a good example. Though there may be times when you need to use your phone or computer for extended periods because of work, try to limit that time so your child doesn't think screen time is a replacement for face-to-face time. First day jitters. Starting preschool or kindergarten can be a nerve-wracking time for your child, but you can prepare him or her for this milestone. Have your child pick out fun school supplies, such as a backpack in his or her favorite color, or a superhero-themed pencil box. Reassure your child that many children will be in the same position and also be scared on the first day. Ask your child if there's something particular about the first day of school that he or she is worried about, so that you can better address it. If your child is nervous, send him or her with a favorite object, such as a book or blanket, to offer comfort. Take advantage of any early tours. Many school districts offer an opportunity for incoming kindergartners to visit their classroom and drop off supplies before the first day of school, when things are less chaotic. You and your child may also have an opportunity to meet the teacher. Highlight all the fun things that your child will get to do in the coming year, such as reading stories, attending class parties, and going on field trips. Adjust your child's sleep schedule about a week ahead of the start of school, so tiredness doesn't make anxiety worse. Have your child spend time with adult relatives or friends if he or she isn't used to being separated from you. Set a specific time for your return to show your child that you will come back. The big picture. The preschool years mark a wonder-filled time for parents and children. It can also be a fast-paced period as you and your child learn to face new challenges and adapt to new rules. But the more work you put in early on, the easier things tend to be later. Sometimes, parents worry that their child may be missing a particular milestone or that their child's skills aren't progressing as expected. Follow the schedule your child's medical provider suggests for well-child exams. These regular checkups focus on your child's growth and development. Talk with your child's provider about any concerns you may have. This can help alleviate fears and answer your questions. Don't forget to look at your child as the unique individual he or she is. Enjoy your child's budding personality during this time. Give your child your time, attention, and unconditional love. Chapter 3. Early Elementary School Years. "Look what I can do" is a phrase you'll hear often during the early years of middle childhood. So many interesting and fun skills to learn. Children at this age can't wait to show you what they've accomplished and for you to celebrate their successes with them. This is also a time when children start to establish the necessary life skills that will help them interact with the world as adults. As your child takes on and masters new challenges, you'll notice some major themes emerging, including budding independence and self-confidence, formation of deeper friendships, learning to try new things, and figuring out how to cope with failure. Children this age are starting to formulate their own ideas and plans and put them into action. They're also improving in their ability to control their emotions and talk about what's bothering them. At the same time, school is becoming a major component of your child's life. Your own relationship with your child will begin to change as classmates, teachers, coaches, and others come into the picture. Your child will gradually rely on you less, but don't think of this blossoming independence as growing away from you. Think of it as your relationship evolving. You'll still be providing plenty of guidance and supervision as your child grows and matures. Physical development and movement. Between the ages of 6 and 8, children continue to grow at a steady rate, even though there's plenty of variation between kids. Some children develop more slowly than others, while others develop faster. Both are okay. Vision and dental concerns may become apparent at this age, but treatment options are widely available. As your child grows into middle childhood, here are some changes you can expect. Height and weight gain. Fairly slow and steady growth will be punctuated with growth spurts. Overall, kids grow about 2.5 inches in height and gain 6 to 7 pounds in weight a year during middle childhood. Keep in mind that physical growth and development varies from child to child based on many factors, including genetics. As long as your child is eating a balanced diet, getting plenty of exercise, and tracking along his or her own growth curve, there's generally no cause for concern about differences between children. If you're worried that your child isn't growing or developing as expected, don't hesitate to bring it up with your child's medical provider. Gross motor development. Your child is getting stronger and more coordinated, which means he or she may be able to pull off some more complex motions, such as mastering new dance moves or finally getting that basketball in the hoop. Your child may also be able to confidently climb a tree, catch a ball with two hands, swim, or ice skate. He or she may begin to favor particular sports, especially ones he or she feels confident in. Examples of gross motor skills at this age include running, galloping, hopping, skipping, kicking, climbing, throwing, catching. As with other age groups, there will be a wide variation in exactly when and how well a child can do a certain task. However, if you have any concerns, don't hesitate to reach out to your child's medical provider to address them. Sometimes these differences can leave your child feeling bad about himself or herself. For example, if he or she isn't as skilled as classmates in gym class, or if learning to ride a bike is more difficult than your child thought it would be. This can be tough. Support your child through the frustration. Encourage your child to keep practicing and also to discover his or her own unique strengths. As your child learns from these experiences, it will become easier for your son or daughter to handle disappointment and move on. It will also help your child become more resilient when facing adversity. The middle childhood years also mark a period when some children become less active. A more sedentary lifestyle can lead to health concerns down the road, such as obesity and diabetes. At a time when children are becoming increasingly aware of their appearance and conscious of their body image, it's important to keep encouraging physical activity and healthy eating habits as a family. If you're concerned about your child's weight, talk with his or her medical provider. The provider can look at your child's growth charts and body mass index measurements to get a clearer picture of your child's weight and growth patterns. Part 3 of this book has more detailed information on fitness and nutrition, as well as on preventing obesity and eating disorders. Fine motor development. As your child's fine motor skills are developing, he or she likely won't need your help as much to complete tasks. Examples of things your child may be able to do now include getting dressed, brushing hair and teeth, tying shoelaces, drawing more detailed pictures, grasping a pencil correctly, and writing neatly. Light the spark. Positive habits to help encourage your child's development in the early elementary years include broadening horizons. Encourage your child to learn a musical instrument or speak a new language. Creativity and expression. Engage your child in arts and crafts, such as making his or her own jewelry or painting a portrait of the family dog. keep an ample supply of art supplies on hand for when the mood strikes your child. Critical thinking. Encourage your child to participate in games that require strategic thinking, such as checkers, chess, or board games. Empathy and compassion. Help your child organize a food collection for a neighborhood soup kitchen. Fostering interests. Develop your child's love for building blocks, action figures, or coins from around the world by helping him or her start a collection. Language skills. Make learning new words and parts of speech fun by playing Mad Libs or a similar word game. Math. Use real-world examples to demonstrate math concepts. For example, learning about fractions through measuring out ingredients for your child's favorite recipe. Reading. Partner read with your child by taking turns reading a page or chapter to each other and then discussing what you just read. Responsibility. Give your child age-appropriate chores, such as feeding the dog or helping with washing the dishes. Offer an allowance to help your child learn how to handle money responsibly. Social skills. Foster your child's social development by encouraging him or her to play cooperative games, take turns, and complete tasks as a team. Self-concept. Catch your child engaging in positive activities or behaviors. Specifically, comment on what your child has done to make you appreciate or be proud of him or her. Vision. Visual skills such as the ability to focus or track moving objects are continuing to develop and improve. At the same time, vision problems may become more apparent during these years, especially once kids start school and are assigned seats in the classroom. If you notice that your child persistently squints, sits close to the television, or complains of not being able to read the board at school, it may be that your child is having difficulty seeing properly. Vision problems may include nearsightedness, myopia. Nearsightedness is when you can't see things far away very well. It usually occurs when the eyeball is longer than normal, or the cornea is curved too steeply. Instead of being focused precisely on the retina, light is focused in front of the retina. The result is that things look blurry from a distance. Farsightedness. Hyperopia. Farsightedness means that objects or letters look blurry close up. This occurs when the eyeball is shorter than normal, or the cornea is curved too little. The effect is the opposite of nearsightedness. Astigmatism. This common problem occurs when the cornea or lens is curved more steeply in one direction than in another. Astigmatism can make things seem a bit blurry all the time. An optometrist or ophthalmologist can perform a complete eye exam and provide prescription eyeglasses if needed. Contact lenses are often reserved for when children are older and can assume greater responsibility for care and use of the lenses. Mild astigmatism doesn't always need correction. In general, children need to be screened for eye disease and have their vision tested by a pediatrician, an ophthalmologist, an optometrist, or another trained screener before first grade and every 2 years during school years, at well child visits, or through school and public screenings. Dental. Starting at around 6 years old, your child will begin to lose baby teeth, which are replaced by permanent teeth. The average child loses about 4 baby teeth a year. Around this age, your child's dentist also may be able to tell you the likelihood of your child needing braces based on problems with your child's tooth alignment, tooth spacing, or bite. If there are any concerns, the dentist will refer your child to an orthodontist for a consultation. Have your child brush twice a day with a pea-sized amount of fluoride toothpaste. Avoid sugary drinks and foods which can damage teeth. Ask your child's dentist whether your child might benefit from a fluoride rinse. See Chapter 7. Cause for concern. No two children act exactly the same, but certain behaviors, such as those listed here, may raise red flags. If these behaviors persist for more than 2 or 3 weeks, seek the help of your child's medical provider or a child psychologist. Emotional concerns. Frequently sad, worried, or afraid. Overly worried about trying and failing or making mistakes. Excessively clingy or has difficulty falling asleep alone. Behavioral concerns. Regresses to younger behaviors. Avoids family activities or interacting with family members. Loses interest in activities that used to be favorites. Acts on impulse or appears out of control. Takes unsafe risks. Has difficulty dealing with emotions, such as anger. Is preoccupied with violence, fire, or cruelty to animals or siblings. Peer concerns. Is uncooperative with other children. Bullies other children. Doesn't have friends or mentions losing friendships. Is easily hurt by peers. Cognitive concerns. Doesn't express own ideas or interests. Has problems communicating. School concerns. Intense dislike of school. Difficulty focusing or staying on task compared with peers. Disruptive behavior in the classroom. Strong avoidance of homework. Physical concerns. Can't physically keep up with peers. Has bedwetting or stool accidents. Has a negative body image. Sleeps too much or too little. Reports ongoing complaints of stomach ache or headache. Experiences weight loss or excessive gain. Misses school repeatedly due to illness. Language and speech. By middle childhood, children are improving their reading and writing and can speak in words and sentences that are easily understood. Your child is also starting to learn that to communicate and cooperate with others more effectively, it helps to take turns when speaking, stay on topic, and follow instructions. Vocabulary is also growing. By 8 years old, most children know about 20,000 words and learn an average of 20 new ones each day. Social and emotional development. Children at this age are developing a stronger sense of what is right or wrong. If you start hearing the expression, "that's not fair," more frequently, don't be surprised. Your child may get upset when someone or something goes against what he or she views as just. As your child gets older, you can help him or her realize that there are many different viewpoints and that the world isn't so black and white. At the same time, your child's ability to feel compassion and sympathy toward others is expanding. Your child is also learning that hard work can yield rewards. A good grade on a project that took a lot of time and effort. He or she is also realizing that not every endeavor will be successful. Diligently practicing soccer skills doesn't mean always being able to score a goal. Learning that not every attempt will end in success is a difficult but important life lesson. Offer your child support and encouragement to keep trying and not take these disappointments to heart. 7 tips for handling sibling fights. If you have more than one child, you've witnessed your fair share of sibling bickering. This is a healthy part of childhood. Typically, children who are close in age show the most rivalry. Help your children learn to handle their own conflicts in these ways. Try to stay out of minor quarrels. If your children come to you with a problem, encourage them to solve the disagreement peacefully on their own. Intervene if a fight escalates. Don't allow hitting, breaking things, or name-calling, for example. if you need to get involved, try to remain fair and neutral. Avoid comparing your children. Give each child a chance to freely express his or her point of view without interruption. Encourage empathy toward one another by asking your children to look at the dispute from different viewpoints. Encourage your children to strive for compromise. Play. Most likely, your child will gravitate toward playmates who are the same sex and who enjoy playing the same games. He or she also is learning that people are complex. For example, a person can be your friend and play with you, but can disappoint you sometimes. Chapter 18 has more on childhood friendships. While fantasy play dominated the preschool years, children in the school-age years start gravitating toward games where there are rules and the ultimate goal is to win. Continue to encourage your child to engage in free play. Unstructured playtime can help boost young brains. Behavior. As they get older, children start to care more about what their peers think. In an attempt to fit in, your child may start to do or say things that he or she knows are wrong, including things that are potentially dangerous. Now is also a common time for children to test boundaries by lying, cheating, or stealing. Talk to your child about peer relationships and friendships, and how he or she can still fit in with peers without engaging in unacceptable or dangerous behavior. Avoid harsh punishments that don't fit the crime. Dealing with prejudice. Children notice differences among people at an early age, even as early as 6 months old. By the time they're preschoolers, children already start to internalize stereotypes, biases, and prejudices that they notice in those around them and what they see and hear in the media. You can teach your child to respect and appreciate human differences. Talking about differences doesn't increase prejudice. It's important that your child receives simple, matter-of-fact answers to questions about differences in characteristics such as ethnicity, race, social class, religion, ability, gender identity, or sexual orientation. Parents often find they need to confront their own biases before teaching their children how to handle the stereotypes and prejudiced viewpoints their children may encounter. It may help to think about the worldviews and filters you've acquired over time. Are they accurate and reflective of current realities? Are they kind and compassionate? Kids quickly become aware of attitudes and unspoken rules. Examine your actions and the messages you're sending to your child. To counteract stereotypes and biases your child may be exposed to, set a good example. The way you treat people who differ from you will create a foundation for your child's behavior. Show your child what it's like to treat all people with respect and courtesy, even when it involves personal discomfort or standing out from the crowd. Discuss prejudice. If your child displays intolerant behavior, talk to him or her about it. Ask why your child acts or feels that way. An honest discussion will help you and your child identify and correct developing biases. When you see an example of prejudice or a stereotype in a movie or in a magazine, point it out to your child. Explore how stereotypes project an oversimplified view of individuals who, in fact, can be very complex. Expose your child to diversity. Encourage your child to interact and form friendships with children from all backgrounds. One of the best ways to learn about other people is to be friends with them. Read books and watch movies about other cultures. Help your child understand that the world is a big and interesting place. Talk about your family heritage. Help your child understand the diversity in his or her own background. Share any family history of immigration. Get active. Be a voice against prejudice in your community. An atmosphere of prejudice can deeply affect children, creating social and emotional tension and causing anxiety and hostility. Being rejected or harassed because of personal characteristics can cause emotional and sometimes physical harm. It can make a child feel unworthy. This can lead to social withdrawal, anxiety, depression, and lower academic performance. If your child experiences bias or prejudice, allow your child to express his or her feelings, which may include anger, fear, or sadness. Provide emotional support and look for ways to bolster your child's self-confidence. Talk with your child about the best way to respond. Sexuality. Interest in sex gradually increases as children get older. Though children often still think of the opposite sex as icky, children this age are becoming increasingly interested in how boys and girls differ. Masturbation is common. It's important for children not to be shamed or punished for their inquisitive nature or actions. Your child may start approaching you more often to answer his or her questions about sex. It may feel awkward talking with your child about sex, but strive to be open and honest in your discussions. And let your child know that you'll always be there to talk. By doing so, you show your child that it's okay for him or her to come to you with questions or concerns, an important step in protecting your child from sexual abuse. Accurate and open communication also increases the odds that your child will understand your values and make appropriate choices about sex later on. Here are some tips for talking with your child about sex. Let your child set the pace with questions. Or, if necessary, ask your child if he or she has any questions. Answer questions in terms your child can easily understand. Teach your child the correct terms for body parts and sexual activity. This gives your child the vocabulary to ask questions and express concerns. Look for everyday opportunities to bring up sex, sexuality, and relationship issues in an age-appropriate manner. As your child matures and asks more detailed questions, provide more detailed answers. Mental development. Your child's mind is developing rapidly during middle childhood. Awareness of the future and the concept of time is improving. Children may enjoy planning out the days and weeks ahead. They may start thinking about what they want to be when they grow up. You may also notice that your child is becoming better at problem solving. As their brains mature, children at this age are able to contemplate decisions and devote longer periods of time to tasks. These are important milestones for being able to learn in school. Gender identity. By middle childhood, most children have developed curiosity about their gender identity, which may be expressed through clothing, behavior, interactions with others, and how a child speaks about self-identity. While gender identity is often the same as the sex your child was born as, sex assigned at birth, this is not always the case. When a child identifies as something other than the sex assigned at birth, this is referred to as gender nonconforming. Some children will not identify with either gender, and some may identify with the opposite gender. Still others may feel like they fall somewhere in between genders. Distress that may accompany the mismatch between sex assigned at birth and gender identity is called gender dysphoria. However, cross-gender behaviors are common in children and may not be associated with dysphoria or persist into adulthood. Children who are gender nonconforming may be at risk of stigma, prejudice, and discrimination, particularly at school. It's natural as a parent to want to protect your child. Some parents may try to encourage a child to adopt more traditional gender-related behaviors or write the child's behavior off as a phase. However, children who are gender nonconforming have better health outcomes when they're affirmed and supported. The most important thing a parent can do for the child is to provide a safe home where the child receives unconditional love and acceptance. If you have any questions about your child's gender identity, speak to your child's medical provider, who can provide resources for you. This may include a referral to a specialist with experience in gender-related concerns. School success. Being involved in your child's education is an important way to help increase your child's academic success, especially during these early years. Transitioning between grades can be difficult for children, as learning environments become more structured and classwork becomes more challenging. The first few years of elementary school are focused on reading, writing, and basic math. By the third grade, the amount of schoolwork increases, and children are required to focus on increasingly complex tasks for at least 45 minutes. Reading moves from recognizing words on sight to reading comprehension and working to understand the content. Writing progresses from spelling words correctly or writing neatly to creating sentences that convey a theme or idea. If you notice your child is struggling, reach out to your child's teacher to share and confirm your child's difficulties. The teacher may have some strategies to help your child. Touch base with teachers frequently to gain observations about your child's learning. A note of encouragement from you, tucked inside a lunchbox or book bag, can give your child an emotional boost during the day. Establishing routines in these areas can help your child stay organized and on track. Homework. Set aside a specific time each day for your child to do homework or study or review topics he or she learned that week. Avoid having your child do homework right before bedtime, which can encourage procrastination and detract from your child's sleep schedule. Help your child create a calendar with all of his or her assignments. This will help your child plan ahead and avoid missing deadlines for homework. Sleep schedule. Enforce a consistent wake-up time and bedtime to ensure your child gets enough sleep each night. Not getting enough rest can negatively impact school performance and behavior. Reading. Spend time each night reading with your child. Learning disorders. Learning disorders affect a child's ability to complete a task or use certain skills, particularly in school, and make it difficult to read, write, or do simple math. Unfortunately, children can go a long time before they're diagnosed with a learning disorder. This can impact academic success and affect a child's self-esteem and motivation. Signs of a potential learning disorder include problems recognizing and writing letters of the alphabet, persistent letter confusion, trouble understanding letter sounds, limited ability to recognize words on sight, difficulty with basic reading and writing tasks, poor handwriting, even with effort, extremely tight pencil grip, difficulty with timed tasks, difficulty learning basic math facts or multiple-step arithmetic, problems understanding directions and resultant behavior issues, poor performance in some academic areas compared with others, problems interacting with peers, persistent reluctance to go to school. If you think your child may have a learning disorder, talk to your child's medical provider and teacher. Early diagnosis and intervention can help your child cope with these obstacles and establish a more secure academic foundation. The importance of the arts. The National Endowment for the Arts published a review of almost 20 studies looking at how the arts impacted social-emotional development. The studies looked at children who participated in activities such as music, dance, theater, drawing, and painting. These children were found to have strong social-emotional skills, such as helping, sharing, empathizing, and regulating their emotions. It's believed that the arts can help foster connections to people and allow children to express feelings and emotions. The gifted child. Children may be considered gifted in any number of areas, including academics, music, the arts, and sports. While there's no one recognized standard for what makes a child gifted, intelligence and skills beyond the child's years are one hallmark. IQ scores are sometimes used to identify varying degrees of academic giftedness. However, these scores aren't always accurate, as factors such as language barriers, attention or behavioral challenges, and poor test-taking skills can affect the results. It might be tempting to think parents of gifted children have an easier time raising their children because of their children's talents. However, these children may have their own challenges. Children who are considered gifted or advanced for their age may have problems fitting in with their peers because their social skills don't always match that of their peers. They may have behavioral problems that stem from the frustration of being bored in the classroom. Gifted children can also struggle with learning disorders and other conditions that can hinder their progress in school, such as attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, ADHD, autism spectrum disorder, anxiety, and depression. To help your child develop his or her gifts, find a program that aligns with your child's abilities and is challenging enough to keep him or her engaged, but not so challenging as to lead to discouragement. Usually, a combination of methods is needed to get the best educational experience. This might include supplemental measures, such as accelerated or enrichment classes, or more comprehensive solutions, such as classrooms or schools that cater to those children with similar advanced intelligence or skills. Should I get my child a cell phone? Some parents wonder, when is a good time for children to get their own phones? Cell phones are a convenient way to keep in touch with your child and can be very helpful in an emergency. However, having a smartphone also exposes a child to risks associated with internet and social media use. In addition, scrolling through apps may replace other more healthy activities, such as playing outside with friends or studying. Among experts, there's no clear-cut consensus on this issue. You know your child best. Consider your child's maturity and responsibility before making a purchase. You might consider purchasing a phone that allows for phone calls and texting, but has very few bells and whistles, such as internet access. Technology. Used appropriately, technology can have benefits for children at this age. The internet can offer children new or differing ideas and knowledge. Email or messenger tools can provide children with the opportunity to connect and collaborate with classmates on homework and school projects. Social media can provide resources to children and their families who are looking for support networks within a certain school or neighborhood, or for a certain health condition. Online groups can also provide inclusion and understanding to children who identify as lesbian, gay, bisexual, or transgender, and their parents. On the other end of the spectrum, excessive screen time at this age has been linked to lack of physical activity and sleep disturbances, and later on, depression and other mental health concerns. The internet can also contain misinformation and inappropriate content for children, as well as present privacy issues. Currently, the American Academy of Pediatrics, AAP, recommends 2 hours or less of screen time daily for this age group, including computers, cell phones, television, and tablets. Consider these tips for guiding your child's media use based on AAP recommendations. Be clear with your child about what types of media he or she is permitted to use. Set limits on duration of media use. Monitor the content your child is being exposed to. Use parental control tools to limit your child's exposure to inappropriate material. Teach your child about online responsibility and safety, such as treating others with respect, avoiding cyberbullying, staying away from online solicitation, and avoiding communication that compromises personal privacy and safety. Develop a network of trusted adults, such as grandparents or other relatives, with whom your child can interact online. Discourage use of entertainment media during homework. Set aside screen-free times, such as during meals, so you can interact as a family. Make sure that screen time doesn't interfere with your child's sleep and physical activity. Shut off screens 1 hour before bedtime to allow time to unplug. Don't allow electronic devices in the bedroom during sleep hours. To set clear and consistent rules on screen time, consider developing and following a family media use plan that outlines times and places for media use. Enjoy these years. As your child grows, learns, and discovers, each day will bring a new layer of identity and potential. Enjoy your child during this time, and know that your support, guidance, and unconditional love play a big part in this amazing transformation. Be a good example for your child. He or she watches what you do. Model the behaviors and beliefs you hope to see in your child. This helps your child understand what you value. And don't forget to incorporate some fun along the way. Chapter 4. Late Elementary School Years. Children in middle childhood are fun to be around. On one hand, they're becoming more independent and don't require the labor-intensive attention of the earlier years. On the other hand, they still like to spend time with their parents, telling silly stories, and sharing the latest knowledge they've acquired. Children now begin to develop a more complex sense of who they are and what their abilities are. They also begin to develop a sense of their place in the world, and they start to learn how to cope with the ups and downs of life. At this age, your child will likely spend much of each day with teachers, care providers, coaches, and friends. But the time you spend with your child during middle childhood is just as important to his or her development as it was during younger years. He or she will still need you for unconditional love and support. Your child may not always come right out and ask for help. Some topics, such as puberty, can be embarrassing to bring up, but stay close and available. Don't be surprised if you find yourself getting into some thought-provoking conversations with your child. He or she has a mind that's developing in wonderful ways, including an increased ability to reason, understand cause and effect, work through hypotheticals, and discuss more abstract ideas. Physically, there's a lot of variance among children this age. As your child's self-concept takes shape, so too does the urge to compare himself or herself to peers. It's helpful to remind your child that people come in all shapes and sizes. Physical development and movement. Your child's body will be undergoing some major changes during the approach to puberty, thanks to the production of the hormones estrogen and testosterone. These changes can leave children feeling a bit unsure or uncomfortable with their bodies. It's important to discuss with your child the physical and even emotional changes that can accompany puberty, ideally before they occur, so that your child is prepared for them. Can a child's adult height be predicted? There's no proven way to predict a child's adult height. However, several formulas can provide a reasonable guess for a child's growth. Here's a popular example. Add the mother's height and the father's height in either inches or centimeters. Add 5 inches, 13 centimeters for boys, or subtract 5 inches, 13 centimeters for girls. Divide by 2. A child's height is largely controlled by genetics. Also, children grow at different rates. Some children begin their growth phases early, while others are late bloomers. If you're concerned about your child's growth, talk to his or her medical provider. Having the provider plot your child's growth on a standardized growth chart can determine if your child is following his or her curve, as well as help predict adult height. Height and weight gain. Growth remains fairly steady, about 6 to 7 pounds of weight gain and 2.5 inches of height increase per year. But this is also a time of growth spurts, with girls typically experiencing them at earlier ages than boys. During a growth spurt, a child can grow up to 4 to 5 inches. These growth spurts usually will correspond with periods of increased appetite and a greater need for sleep. Because puberty-related changes to the body can result in weight gain that's concentrated in areas such as the belly, children may be tempted to diet or restrict eating. Continue to promote healthy, flexible eating habits and plenty of physical activity. For more on helping your child maintain a healthy body image and healthy eating habits, gross motor development. Running, jumping, and skipping are likely second nature at this stage. Now that body control has greatly improved, your child is focusing more on becoming stronger and faster. He or she is fine-tuning motor skills that allow for more coordinated movement and perhaps competing in favorite sports, such as passing a soccer ball to a teammate, walking a balance beam, or dribbling a basketball. Fine motor development. Improved handwriting and drawing skills are evidence of your child's fine motor development. Your child may also display greater ability in using tools and cooking utensils and manipulating small objects. A preference for using the right hand or left hand, which begins to emerge in the preschool years and gradually becomes more evident, is typically set by this point. Vision. If your child wears glasses, you may notice his or her vision worsening. Visit regularly with your child's eye doctor. Blurry vision when looking at objects far away, called nearsightedness or myopia, typically develops during the early elementary school years and may worsen throughout the teen years. It may rapidly worsen around the ages of 11 to 13. By the late teens, vision usually stabilizes. Dental. With adult teeth coming in at a rate of approximately 4 per year, you can expect your child to have about 8 permanent incisors, the teeth that neighbor the front teeth, and 4 permanent molars, the larger teeth toward the back of the mouth. Around age 11, you will see emerging premolars. The smaller teeth are in front of the larger molars. Cause for concern. It's not uncommon during this time to have concerns about your child's emotions and behavior. Most school-age kids feel down or act out from time to time. But if your child displays persistent negative emotions or behaviors for several weeks, speak with his or her medical provider. Addressing concerns and identifying underlying causes at an early stage can help your child get the assistance he or she needs. Part 4 of this book has more information on childhood emotions and behaviors. Chapter 14 has guidance on body image concerns. Emotional concerns. Is sad or depressed most days? Is overly anxious, nervous, or worried? Has extreme mood swings? Loses interest in activities he or she once enjoyed? Is easily discouraged by failures? Talks about hurting or killing himself or herself. Physical concerns. Lacks signs of growth or other physical changes. Has gained more weight than expected at this age and is sedentary. Shows poor appetite. Body image concerns. Closely monitors food intake or counts calories. Is afraid of gaining weight. Binge eats. Is preoccupied with exercising. Behavioral concerns. Is disrespectful or defiant, argues often. Withdraws from family and friends. Is overly dependent. Engages in risky or potentially harmful behaviors. frequently gives in to peer pressure, has violent outbursts, bullies or harms others, has been bullied or harmed, shows signs of abusing drugs or alcohol. Sexual development. The first stages of puberty generally begin anywhere between ages 8 to 13 in girls and ages 9 to 14 in boys. The onset of puberty provides a good opportunity to talk with your child about sexual development, whether or not you've already done so. You can help prepare your child for the cascade of changes that his or her body will go through during the next few years. The goal is for your child to welcome these changes without shame or anxiety that they're occurring too quickly or too slowly. Don't worry if your child's puberty starts a little earlier or later than that of his or her peers. This is rarely a medical problem. However, your child may feel awkward and self-conscious about diverging from the average schedule. Be sensitive to your child's feelings. Reassure your child that he or she is fine. It may help to stress that every child, including your child and each of his or her peers, is traveling along the same road toward adulthood, and that everyone takes a different amount of time to arrive. Girls and puberty. Though age can vary, it's typically around 9 or 10 that girls begin to experience the first signs of puberty. Multiple factors, such as race and weight, can affect timing. Signs and symptoms include breast buds. These feel like small, firm lumps beneath the nipples that may feel tender or sore. It can be easy to mistake this for a cyst or other abnormal growth, but rest assured, it's normal. Pubic hair. In many girls, the second sign of approaching puberty is the development of pubic hair, which typically comes in as thin, sparse hairs. As time goes on, these will begin to grow darker and coarser in texture. Body shape. Girls tend to add fat around their stomach area in preparation for redistribution to hips and breasts. Unless the weight gain is excessive, there is typically no cause for concern. However, some girls may be upset to see their body take on a more rounded appearance. Reassure your daughter that this is normal and discourage the temptation to diet. Menstruation. Girls typically get their periods about 2 to 2.5 years after the development of breast buds, so now is the perfect time to prepare her for this milestone. Be open and honest in discussions you have with your child about menstruation and be available for any questions. Prepping for periods. Menstruation can be a bit mysterious and scary for girls. They may be afraid of suddenly getting their period at school and of being unprepared, or worry that menstruation is painful. Some may think that getting their periods means they won't be able to do the things they used to do, such as swimming. An open discussion about menstruation ahead of time can soothe these fears. Ovulation is a tricky topic for a child to understand, so you may want to show your daughter a diagram of the female reproductive system to help you explain why and how it happens. Here's an example of how to describe menstruation in a kid-friendly way. Your ovaries are two small, grape-sized organs filled with hundreds of thousands of tiny eggs. Around puberty, your ovaries begin to release eggs. Once this begins, if you have sex and one of your eggs is fertilized, you could become pregnant. If the egg isn't fertilized, the egg and the lining of your uterus are eliminated, shed, through your vagina. This may look like a lot of blood, but it's not really that much. When this happens, it's called having your period, menstrual cycle. You wear a pad in your underwear or a tampon to absorb the fluid and change the pad or tampon every few hours. Each period typically lasts 2 to 8 days. It's very common for your first few periods to be irregular and unpredictable. Keep track on a calendar when your periods begin. Over the next 2 or 3 years, your periods will become more predictable, and you'll probably start to see a pattern. So you'll know approximately when to expect the next one. On average, periods occur every 28 days, or once a month. But everyone is different. Most girls get their periods about 21 to 35 days apart. You might also discuss that periods can be uncomfortable, and that many girls have premenstrual symptoms, often called PMS, in the days before a period begins. Common symptoms include cramps, headaches, bloating, feeling tired, mood swings, and breast tenderness. Over-the-counter medications such as ibuprofen can help with pain relief. With discussions about menstruation starting before her period begins, your daughter may be curious about when she'll actually get hers. While girls tend to get their first periods around the same time as their mothers did, there's no way to know for sure, so it's good to be prepared. Show your child how to use a sanitary pad and have her carry one in her backpack, just in case. While your child may choose to use tampons later on, it's a good idea to have her start off with pads, which are generally easier to use. When puberty comes early. The term precocious puberty is used to define puberty signs and symptoms that come before age 8 in girls and before age 9 in boys. For girls, this might mean breast growth before age 8. For boys, it may mean enlarged testicles and penis before age 9. Both girls and boys may develop pubic or underarm hair, rapid growth, acne, and adult body odor at this early age. In many cases, the cause of precocious puberty isn't known and is attributed to a puberty process that just starts too soon. In other cases, an underlying medical disorder, genetics, or exposure to external sources of estrogen or testosterone, such as creams and ointments, may be to blame. Potential complications include shorter height and self-esteem issues. Children displaying early signs of puberty should be evaluated by their medical provider. The provider will perform tests to determine what may be causing precocious puberty. Depending on the trigger, treatments such as medications to delay further puberty-related development until the proper age or addressing underlying medical conditions may be recommended. Boys and puberty. As with girls, when boys start puberty varies, but it's often around age 10 or 11. At this time, most boys are starting to undergo significant physical changes. Testes enlargement. At the beginning stages of puberty, the testicles and scrotum almost double in size. Skin on the scrotum undergoes several changes in appearance, including darkening and the development of hair follicles, which appear as small bumps. One testicle may hang lower than the other. Eventually, the penis grows longer, then wider. There may be pimple-like growths close to the head of the penis. These normal growths are called papules and don't require treatment. This is a time when boys may compare their genitalia to their peers. If your child is concerned about differences, you might point out to your child that penis size and appearance vary greatly among children, and that this is rarely a reason to worry. Pubic hair. Your son may notice a few soft hairs around the base of his penis, which will eventually turn thicker and curlier. Later on, the pubic hair will spread up in a thin line to the belly button. Body shape. As puberty sets in, some boys look to be all arms and legs. Others might be shorter than most girls for a while. In general, boys' bodies will even out during growth spurts, when height increases and the trunk of the body grows and catches up. As puberty progresses, fat is replaced by muscle. Ejaculation and erections. Though your son likely knows by now that touching his penis can bring about good feelings, this is around the time when children become sexually mature enough to orgasm and ejaculate. Ejaculation may happen as a child masturbates or involuntarily while he sleeps, wet dream. Your child may be confused and embarrassed when he wakes up with the bed wet. Assure your son that this happens to all boys and that these involuntary occurrences will gradually stop. Though erections are typically associated with sexual arousal, a boy's penis can become hard for no identifiable reason during puberty. There's not much a boy can do about them, except take some comfort in the fact that these occurrences will decrease in frequency as time goes on. Voice. Toward the end of middle childhood, you may notice your child's voice occasionally cracking. This is temporary and a normal part of puberty related to the growing voice box, larynx, and changing vocal cords. Breasts. Though breast growth is something more commonly associated with girls, it does occur in boys as well. Your son may complain about sensitivity or discomfort in the nipple area. This is normal. In some boys, breast growth may be more extensive, a condition called gynecomastia. This condition usually disappears in a year or two. However, it's a good idea to check with your child's medical provider to ensure it's not the result of an underlying condition, medication, or overexposure to products containing ingredients that mimic estrogen, the hormone that most strongly influences female sexual development. Light the spark. Positive habits to help encourage your child's development in the late elementary years include community. Encourage your child to take part in local community groups or volunteer for a local charity. Responsibility. Teach your child to take on more complicated tasks, such as doing laundry, preparing a simple meal, or packing a school lunch the night before. Resilience. Encourage your child to try an activity that provides a reasonable degree of challenge. If your child doesn't succeed at first, use it as a lesson in how to handle drawbacks and disappointments. Make effort and persistence key parts of the learning process. Thinking ahead. Have your child interview adult family members, friends, or neighbors about what they do for a living. Help your child think of questions to ask, such as what the job entails, how long the person has done it, and whether the job requires special training or education. Critical thinking. Take your child grocery shopping with you and discuss how to shop. For example, how to decide between brands, pick the freshest fruits and vegetables, and compare prices. Help your child learn how stores are organized by having him or her pick items from the grocery list and find them in the store. Global awareness. Watch the news with your child, making notes about people and places mentioned. Help your child learn more about them by researching them online after the news program is over. 6 ways to boost your child's self-confidence. 1. Set aside time to hang out and talk, whether it be about friends, accomplishments, or setbacks. 2. Be involved in your child's school. Maintain regular contact with your child's teachers and attend school events. 3. Encourage your child to be a joiner, participating in school and community groups. 4. Talk about not giving in to peer pressure. Support at home and a healthy sense of self-worth can help your child handle social demands appropriately. 5. Do things together as a family. 6. Show affection and offer praise regularly. Language and speech. By the time a child is in 4th and 5th grade, language gains many more uses. You may notice your child's increasingly sophisticated use of words to joke, argue, and ask questions. Your child's quick wit or dry humor may catch you by surprise. You may also find that the two of you are able to hold some pretty in-depth conversations. Slang, as well as swear words, may make their way into conversation. The latter may prompt reminders from you about what's appropriate language in your family and what's not. This is also the time when children are getting better at understanding figurative language, such as it's hotter than the sun out there. The way they talk and write sentences also is becoming more sophisticated. In fact, older children may be writing their own stories. In late elementary years, children can typically translate ideas into words, learn new words by looking at the context of a sentence, better organize thoughts and information in speech and writing, write stories that include a beginning, middle, and an end, conduct research to write on a specific topic, read between the lines or understand what an author means, even if the idea isn't explicitly stated, read developmentally appropriate books without many mistakes, moving from simple chapter books to more complex stories. Social and emotional development. The world is starting to develop more layers in your child's eyes. He or she is realizing that people have different points of view and that he or she may not always agree with them. These later elementary school years also mark a time when your child can become more easily upset by criticism. As a parent, you can model constructive criticism by focusing on actions and behaviors rather than the individual. Your child's interest in social activities is increasing at this age, and deeper bonds are formed with friends. With it, the pressure to act like peers or look like them becomes more common. Children can sometimes see their self-esteem suffer as a consequence. Support your child through the ups and downs of friendships while continuing to reinforce your family's values. Behavior. At this age, children are capable of greater responsibility, such as doing chores around the house or helping parents by keeping an eye on a younger sibling. Greater awareness of factors, such as picking up trash in the park, may stem from children's growing sense of the bigger picture or how behavior can impact not just themselves, but the people and sometimes the world around them. At the same time, children this age will continue to test their parents and the rules. As your child strives for independence, he or she may act moody or rude. You may find your child doing things you don't approve of or that may be risky. Though your child likely understands that what he or she is doing is unacceptable, it's important to clarify your expectations and follow through with appropriate consequences. Sparks of romance. Children at this age may develop their first crush. It's also not uncommon for children this age to develop platonic crushes on peers of the same sex. These early crushes are generally temporary, but may provide an opportunity to discuss why people fall in love and what elements are important in a healthy romantic relationship. Mental development. In the late elementary years, school is geared toward challenging a child's critical thinking and problem-solving skills. Though your child may complain about homework assignments, these after-school tasks can help him or her learn to work more independently. Children at this age also like to be involved in family decision-making and planning, and enjoy knowing what's ahead. A shared family schedule or calendar can help family members stay up to date and connected. Preparing for middle school. Depending on how your local school district divides up grades, your child may be preparing to head off to middle school or junior high school soon. Starting middle school can be a scary time for a child, as he or she may be confronted with several major changes all at once. For some kids, going to middle school means there's a new building to navigate, and there may be new classmates to meet. It may also mean your child will once again be the youngest in the school, and he or she may have to follow a schedule and move to different classrooms throughout the day. Grades take on a more important role in your child's academic career. If you ask children starting middle school what worries them the most, they may tell you about not being able to open a locker or getting lost trying to find a classroom. They may have heard stories about how mean eighth graders are or the mountains of homework middle school teachers give out. As a parent, you play a central role in helping to soothe your child's fears. To get your child ready, prep together mentally. Focus on the fun things he or she will do, but also listen to your child's concerns and fears and address them. For example, if your child is worried about getting lost in the new school, reassure him or her that many other classmates will be in the same position and that there will be plenty of staff to help new students find their way around. Take advantage of orientation. This is usually a time when elementary students entering middle school and their parents can learn more about the school and activities offered, meet staff, and take a tour of the school. There may be icebreaker events to get children acquainted with middle school, such as picnics or ice cream socials during the summer before school starts. Get involved with the school. Attend school meetings and keep in touch with your child's teacher. Consider volunteering with organizations such as your school's Parent and Teacher Association, PTA. Find ways to have a say in what fun activities are available at your child's school. Get help when needed. The transition from elementary school to middle school isn't always smooth. Coupled with major changes associated with puberty, this can be a tough time. If your child is showing signs of struggling, feeling persistently sad or anxious, experiencing changes in appetite or sleep patterns, or losing interest in friends and activities over a period of weeks, consider talking to someone. Your child's care provider, a guidance counselor, or other mental health professional can provide you and your child with mental health strategies that can help both now and later in life. Organization and time management. As your child moves on to more advanced grades and multiple assignments and teachers become the norm, he or she may need to become more organized and better able to manage time constraints. To help keep your child on track, keep a planner. A calendar, whether on paper or online, can be helpful to children learning to keep track of tasks and assignments. Try a checklist. Have your child compile a list of things he or she needs to get done for the day or week, whether it's schoolwork or chores. It can be gratifying for children to check off completed tasks and see how much they've accomplished. Break up assignments. Show your child how doing work in smaller chunks over a longer period can be more manageable. For example, instead of writing a book report over the weekend, set aside a week ahead of time to write a section each day. Help your child navigate online calendars and assignments. Many schools have websites that contain important information, such as schedules and assignments. In addition, schools often require children to submit their homework online. Some elementary schools may even assign student tablets or laptops. Although this is more common in middle and high school, sit down with your child and familiarize yourselves with these online tools so that you both know what's expected. Teachers generally fill parents in on websites to be used, as well as usernames and passwords, but seek clarification if you need it. Schedule a weekly backpack cleanout. At the end of each week, remove papers and other items from the backpack and have your child decide what needs to be kept and what can be thrown out.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.